Thank you, Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen. It's a great pleasure for me to be here, and I would like to thank Professor Milan Dimkic for invitation and the very close cooperation within the last 10 years. Thank you very much, Milan. My presentation today is dealing with the interactions between river water quality and groundwater quality from the perspective of drinking water production. I would like to point out some significance of natural attenuation processes for improving water quality. The general motivation for our work is to improve water quality. This means groundwater quality, surface water quality for drinking water production, as well as to secure and safeguard the water resources for aquatic organisms and the next generations. I'll give you some more information of public water supply along the major rivers in Central Europe, for River Rhine, River Elbe, River Danube. I would give some words on river bank filtration and or artificial recharge. And will focus my talk on the fate of basic water quality parameters and the fate of organic micropollutants in underground processes. In Central Europe, in Europe, groundwater is used for drinking water production wherever possible. In Germany, at a total of 6 billion cubic meters per year, 65% is coming from groundwater resources, 9% from spring water, and about 13 from bank filtrate and infiltrate, as well as 12% for lakes and dams. This means 25% or 26% from surface water. The usage of direct river water has declined up to below 1% at the moment. Groundwater is often used because it is well protected in Germany. It means the overall area in Germany between 10 and 11% is protected for drinking water production. In this water protection zones, groundwater is well protected against pollution. This means against fertilizer, pesticide residues, and so on. But outside of this water protection zone, groundwater will become more and more polluted by industrial activities or by agriculture activities, by using fertilizer, nitrate problem, or pesticide problem. But groundwater has, in most cases, a regular quality and temperature. There are no problems with pathogens. The abstraction can be easily adjusted to short-term fluctuations in consumption. But in some cases along the major rivers, in some regions, it is quantitatively restricted. Surface water, in comparison, this is not quantitatively restricted, but it is not protected. Like water protection zones, it is not protected against pollution. There are a lot of different risk and pollution pathways. Surface water serves as the receiving water for wastewater effluents, and there's overall problems with pathogens, emergent pathogens, and so on. In Germany, we have about 300 bank filtration sites along the major rivers or minor rivers. We have about 40 waterworks which use artificial groundwater recharge, for example, in the Berlin area or in the Ruhr Valley. If you use a surface water as a drinking water resource, you have to face some risk and relating to pollution. Wastewater, I mentioned wastewater effluents. This means chemical and hygienic risks. You have some problems with superficial runoff after heavy rainfalls. This means also chemical and hygienic risk. There are a lot of accidental spills by industrial activities along the major river, for example, at the River Rhine. This in the past there was there some illegal discharges from chemicals, from chemical production sites or by boats or the ships. There are some floods. This means chemical and hygienic risks. The picture is from the River Elbe in the city of Dresden in the year 2002. And there are some problems with mismanagement of water authorities and so on. Well-known problems with accidental spills was, for example, the cyanide disaster in January 2000 in the Danube catchment area in the Upper Tisa Basin, where a lot of fish were killed, and the drinking water as well as the aquatic environment were severely affected by this cyanide spill. Second, which was already mentioned by Philip Weller, was also from mining activities, from mining industries, the Red Sludge disaster in October 2011, where 9 people were killed, and the environment was severely polluted, and 2 villages were partly destroyed. Another risk on surface water along along rivers was the transportation or industrial activities, the transportation and the discharges of chemicals into the surface water. There was a spill of sulfuric acid in January 2011. More recent, on transportation of organic solvents, of petroleum, of fuels, and other chemicals may pose a higher risk for water quality. Another example was extremely high concentration of 1,2-dichloroethane in the lower river section, very close to the Dutch border, up to 150 microgram per liter of 1,2-dichloroethane. If we talk of bank filtrated water, we have two options: the riverbank filtration, as Professor Tim Kitsch already mentioned in his presentation this morning, and artificial groundwater recharge. Riverbank filtration, the water for drinking water production is extracted nearby in wells nearby the river, and is further treated, for example, along the river with oxidation techniques like ozone, activated carbon filtration, and disinfection via chlorine or chlorine dioxide or UV disinfection. Artificial groundwater recharge is often used in the lower section of rivers, for example in the Netherlands, for example for dune filtration, or in the Ruhr Valley, the smaller tributary in North Rhine-Westphalia in the northwestern part of Germany, where artificial groundwater is used. This means there's a direct abstraction of water. This water is pre-treated, then infiltrated into the underground, and then taken and further treated with, for example, with oxidation processes or with filtration processes. If you want to understand the processes going on in the underground, this figure shows a general overview about the redox succession of the redox sequence during infiltration. Surface water has, in most cases, enough oxygen, maybe 6 to 8 milligrams per liter, but the oxidation was first reduced and within the first meters, or in some cases in the first centimeters. And so with the groundwater flow, also the hydrochemical changes and the parameters changed. So we came from an aerobic status to more or less denitrifying status, and finally may in some cases in an anaerobic status. These redox conditions are very important for the removal of the biodegradation or degradation of organics within the underground. Last slide is the normal riverbank filtrate location. The infiltration of the river water is not on the border, right or the left border, so in the zone where the highest velocity of the river took place. We have a lot of benefits for river bank filtration. For example, at the River Rhine, in the medium section of the River Rhine, of the lower section, the river bank filtration is at present a very natural treatment stop. This means not green chemistry, not green pharmacy, but green water technology. In my point of view, this includes some sorption, some biodegradation, dilution, infiltration processes. It's a self-cleaning capacity, is free of cost. No application of treatment chemicals is needed. It's a good removal, or excellent removal of particles of micro and macro organisms, NOMs, natural organic matter, as well as inorganic organic chemicals like heavy metals are totally eliminated during underground passage. It can replace and supports other treatment steps, for example, filtration steps. There's temperature equalization. This means that in summer season, the water, surface water is up to 25 degrees in the underground, if 15 up to 16 degrees. The peak smoothing is built like accidental speeds I already showed you, and there's elimination or reduction of anthropogenic organic chemicals. But also in the a very good, excellent removal of microorganisms, for example, pathogens, emergent pathogen bacteria, protozoa, pathogenic microorganisms due to a slow groundwater velocity, to sufficient flow path length and residence time. This residence time between 10 and maybe 15 up to 100 days or up to 1 year residence time in some cases. And the granular materials with an open pore space. Within the last years, we are studying a lot of different riverbank filtrations. For example, two locations in the River Rhine, one in the River Elbe, and one in the River Ruhr, with different redox conditions, aerobic to denitrifying, and strictly anaerobic, with different retention times, key values, and aquifer thickness. But I want to go to more in detail. I want to show you more in data and results of our investigations. For example, the amino carboxylates, this means three dominant substances like NTA, EDTA, or DTPA are very well-known compounds, often used as complexing or chelating agents in various applications worldwide. NTA is readily biodegradable during underground passage, it is completely removed, whereas DTPA is only partly biodegraded, and NTE is, there's not a reduction of concentrations, maybe a small increase. This means maybe the formation of EDTA from DTPE biodegradation. Other results I will present here to you. It's of aromatic sulfonates, often used for the textile industry. Most of them are readily biodegraded in the underground, in the underground, where special, for example, 1,5 naphthalene disulfonate is not biodegraded in the concentration is the same as in river water and in the wells after bank filtration. This means the higher, and so the right-hand side of the figure, there's other compounds where the elimination rate is relatively low. If you have a look on the anaerobic conditions, there's most of these compounds cannot be degraded in comparison to aerobic conditions. If we have a look of some pharmaceutical compounds under aerobic conditions, there's only a few compounds are not readily biodegraded under aerobic conditions. This is, for example, carbamazepine, sulfamethoxazole, and iodinated X-ray contrast media. These compounds are very well known. They were often investigated all over the world, in the United States, in Australia, as well as in other European countries. They are partly persistent under aerobic conditions, whereas the other compounds are readily biodegraded under aerobic conditions. If we have a look on the anaerobic conditions, you see here, for example, the iodinated contrast media, iopamidol, for example, is better removed during underground passage than under aerobic condition. This can be explained due to a dehalogenation or deiodination of this compound, release of iodine by biodegradation. If we have a look and to compare the different redox conditions, aerobic, suboxic, anoxic, anaerobic, you see for these compounds, carbamazepine, iopamidol, or sulfamethoxazole, there's a higher removal rate under anaerobic conditions than in comparison to aerobic conditions. But this, I think, is a special results here. In most cases, if we have a look on the next figure, comparison to aerobic and anaerobic condition, anoxic conditions, some compounds are better removed under aerobic condition, other compounds are better removed under anaerobic conditions. For example, high chlorinated compounds are better eliminated under anaerobic conditions. This means the reductive dehalogenation. This is well known in the literature, for example, hexachlorobenzene or lindane, or for example, the triazine compounds, atrazine, is better removed under anaerobic, anoxic condition than under aerobic conditions. There's an overall figure of the effect of riverbank filtration at the lower Rhine on micropollutants. Most of these compounds can be eliminated during riverbank filtration processes, but for surrogate parameters, for DOC or AOX, we have only a removal of 30 up to 50%. But at present, there's a new field of scientific research is the formation and identification of transformational products or metabolites within. This means that readily biodegradable compounds can form relatively stable or persistent metabolites, which can be found and identified in drinking water resources. If we have a look on the other water quality parameters like DOC, you see the best removal rate is taking place within the first meters of infiltration zone. This is for DOC as well as for AOX, adsorbable organic halogen, and is often confirmed in different riverbank locations all over the world. But if we have a look on anaerobic conditions, there's often direct removal of nitrate within the first meters for nitrite, but it's the formation of ammonium, as Professor Dimkic talked about this morning. There's a sharp increase of the iron concentration, the manganese concentration within in the underground, and sulfate was was transformed as nitrate forming in some cases H2S. If we have a look on this figure, the pro and cons of aerobic status. In most cases, aerobic status is much more better for drinking water preparation than anaerobic conditions. We have a minor oxygen reduction, we have no nitrate and sulfate transformation, we have very low release of iron and manganese. This caused a lot of problems to remove iron and manganese in higher concentrations. We have a removal of TOC or DOC and AOX, in most cases, more than 50%. We have an excellent elimination of microorganisms and pathogens, but we have, in some cases, a low removal rate for organic halogen compounds, like chlorinated compounds or ionated compounds. I will come to my conclusion. The fate of organic micropollutants during river bank filtration or artificial groundwater recharge can hardly be predicted. This is the case. Chemical similar compounds show sometimes very different elimination rates. If you have a look on the aromatic sulfonates with different structures, and the major part of the elimination proceeds always in the first few meters of the infiltration pathways. This is also confirmed in different studies and investigations, and longer retention times can significantly improve removal rates of some compounds. Biodegradation of individual compounds is very often dependent on the redox status, aerobic, anaerobic, anoxic, and the redox condition have a more effect on the removal capacity than the residence time in the underground, and the removal capacity seems to be quite robust with regard to changes in river water flow, to river water temperature, and as well as the discharge. The overall finding is the overall water quality was improved during subsurface processes by riverbank filtration, via riverbank filtration, or by artificial groundwater recharge. This is the same in the Danube River basin. There's a lot of investigation and studies have been performed within the last year. So the processes and the chemicals are quite the same. The concentrations are often quite lower in the Danube catchment area in comparison to the Rhine due to less industrial activities, due to higher river water flow of the river Danube. But the overall processes responsible for degradation and removal of the compounds are quite the same. Thank you very much for your attention.